Hello, Mr. Bakaloudis. Dear colleagues, welcome everybody. Thank you for joining our fifth webinar. I'm Danka Slavova from Bulgarian Biodiversity Foundation, and I will be hosting the webinar for you. This time, our topic is connected to population size and significance to the viability of species, of wild species. You already see Mr. Bakaloudis, Associate Professor Bakaloudis, who is working in Faculty of Forestry in Aristotelis University. He will be our lecturer today. I will ask you to mute yourself unless you want to ask a question. Whenever you want to ask a question, you can unmute yourself and ask a question, or also use the chat in the Zoom platform to write your questions. We will wait only 2-3 minutes and we can start with Mr. Bakaloudis. Thank you very much again for joining.
Thank you, Zadanga. Thank you for introducing me. So, are we waiting for more students?
It's exactly 5 now, the exact time that we should start. I think we should wait only 1-2 minutes, not more, and start, because everybody seems to be on time.
Okay, just let me know when I will start. Okay.
Okay, I think we can start.
Okay.
I'm giving the floor to Mr. Dimitrios Bakaloudis.
Okay.
Okay.
Do you listen to me? It's okay. Zurnaga, do you listen to me?
Yes, yes, we hear
okay.
You.
Okay. Hello, dear students, dear colleagues. Have a nice afternoon. So thank you very much for introducing me, Jordanka. In my presentation today, I will try to bring to our memory, firstly, some basic terms coming from the ecology discipline, and then to develop step by step the lecture. In this presentation, I will talk about characteristics of small populations, why some populations are naturally small versus declining population. I will talk about stochastic and deterministic threats to small populations, some terms about the minimum sizes for viable population. Also, we will talk about the effective population size and the uses. And finally, I will close with some examples about management and conservation for small populations, mainly from Greece or from Europe. I hope when finishing this talk, everybody must understand the forces, intrinsic and extrinsic factors that decline populations, and how concepts of population ecology can be used to conserve and manage natural wildlife populations. In addition, everybody can discuss appropriate management measures taken for small or declining populations. And finally, to understand the role of deterministic and stochastic factors. Sorry. Before starting my talk, I would like to make everybody of thinking. Many times we questioned ourselves about what factors, for example, are most likely to explain global amphibian declines, and what is the most efficient way to prevent this. How is the proportion of male and female tortoises changing due to global warming? Are there in Greece few and declining, or many and increasing? How many black vultures are in a national park, and how fast they dying and reproducing? I will start with some basic knowledge. The first question is, what is ecology? Firstly, Haeckel, in two centuries ago, used the term ecology, and the word is derived from the Greek ekos, meaning home. In this context, ecology might be thought as the study of the home life of living organisms. A common term used for ecology is the scientific study of the interactions between organisms and their environment, but a more informative has been suggested by Krebs in 1972 that ecology is a scientific study of the interactions that determine the distribution and abundance of organisms. This definition pinpoints a fundamental subject in ecology: the distribution and the abundance of organisms. Where organisms occur, how many there are, and what they do. Ecology as a science deals with three levels of concern: the individual organism, how individuals are affected by the biotic and abiotic environment; at the level of population, ecology deals with the presence or absence of particular species, with their abundance or rarity, and with their trends and fluctuations in their numbers. And community ecology deals with the composition or structure of communities and with the pathways followed by energy, nutrients, and other chemicals. A second fundamental question is, what is population and its characteristics? A population is the number of individuals of the same species that live in a particular geographic area at the same time, with the ability of interbreeding and further produce fertile offspring. The population of species or organisms has some distinctive characteristics, and they include population size and density. This is the most important parameter of a population, and it is the number of individuals present in a specified area. This is the population size. Despite the simplicity of this term, observing all individuals of a wildlife species during a census is nearly impossible. So we usually estimate population size by counting a sample of individuals, and then we extrapolate it to the whole population or to a larger area. Population density is defined as the numbers of individuals per unit area or per unit volume. Let's see an example. The mud swan in a lake may consist it by a small number of individuals, and thus its density is relatively slow. In contrast, fish in the same lake are more abundant, and therefore they have a higher density. A A second characteristic of population is a dispersion or spatial distribution. This is the spatial pattern of arrangement of individuals within a population. Type of dispersion can provide insights into processes such as competition and territoriality. There are three types of dispersion. Firstly, the uniform dispersion. Individuals are evenly spaced over the area they occupy. This is typical of species in which individuals compete for a scarce environmental resource. Secondly, the random dispersion. Here, individuals have an unpredictable distribution. This is typical of species in which individuals do not interact strongly, and it is not a common pattern in nature. And the third type of dispersion is a clump dispersion. Individuals here are clustered together in groups in some places and are absent in others. This is probably reflects a patch distribution of resources in the environment, and it is the most common pattern of population dispersion. A third characteristic of a population is the demographic structure or the age sex structure, because this term includes these two properties. Demographic structure is the composition of a population as determined by the proportion of males and females arranged in each age class. It is the cumulative result of past trends in fertility, mortality, and migration. Therefore, the structure of population influences its dynamic. Demographic structure could be expressed graphically with a population pyramid, even though an age sex structure is not always pyramidal in shape. There are different shapes of population age sex structure, and the most common in wildlife ecology are the following four types. Firstly, the leftmost figure, a pyramid with a broad base and a very sharp top, representing a rapidly growing population with a high fraction of young individuals, and they decreases rapidly with age. The second, a pyramid showing that the proportion of individuals decreases steadily with age. Third, a bell-shaped diagram showing a stable population. Here, the other part of population is a larger proportion than in any other diagram. And finally, the rightmost diagram represents a declining population. In this type, the high proportions of individuals are in the middle and older ages. It is important to create a profile of the age sex structure of a species in order to determine the reproductive potential of that population and also to estimate current and future growth. Some age classes within a population have a greater impact on population level processes, for example, in population growth. Population growth or vital age of a population is primarily affected by birth and death, while immigration and emigration have also a significant effect. Fecundity describes the number of offspring a population is able to produce in a given period of time and may be expressed as the number of births per unit of time, or number of births per female per unit of time. Like fecundity, mortality is measured in rates and usually expressed as the number of individuals that die in a given period. Births and immigration add individuals per population, while deaths and immigration remove individuals from a population. Populations consisting with higher proportion of reproducing individuals or facing lower mortality rate may increase in the future. A fifth characteristic of any animal population is its genetic structure and origin. Genetic structure of an animal population describes the total genetic diversity and its distribution within and among a set of populations. There are different differences among individuals within populations, and there are also differences among different populations of a certain species. It is not in the scope of my talk to go more in depth in genetics, but I will briefly try to approach its significance in wildlife ecology and conservation. Understanding the genetic composition is important for restoring wildlife populations. In particular, when we would like to restore small populations, we have to pay attention of translocations. An example is coming from a recent publication of Poulakakis et al. Concerning the phylogeography of black vultures. They found an east-west allopatric differentiation among black vulture populations. In addition, according to mitochondrial DNA analysis, they found that there are four distinct groups of populations in Eurasia. Despite the black vulture population in Balkans is closer to that of Iberian Peninsula, significant genetic differences in some haplotypes exist between these two subpopulations. Therefore, if our goal is to preserve genetic distinctiveness, introductions of birds should be discouraged. Finally, an important characteristic that a wildlife population has is feeding habits. Diet or feeding habits of a wildlife population refers to the ability of obtaining nutrients and the ways in which it adapted to its particular environment in order to survive and reproduce. While broad similarities in nutritional needs exist among group of animals, there are significant differences among species of the same group, within species by season, gender and age, and sometimes among subpopulations or regions. An interesting example is the feeding habits of the golden eagle in around the world. The golden eagle has a wide distribution in the northern hemisphere, and it feeds principally on medium-sized mammals such as fox and hares, and secondly on birds such as geese or grouse. However, in warmer climates and in regions with a high availability of reptiles, like in the Mediterranean basin, it feeds mainly on tortoises, and such variation in feeding habits should always take in consideration, especially in reintroduction projects. My presentation concerns the ecology and conservation of small populations. I have already talked about the properties of wildlife population and for some interesting thoughts in conservation. Recently, many wildlife species face an exceptional threat of extinction due to human activities. Species with small population, this is the rare species, are much more susceptible to extinction than those with large population or wide geographical range. However, some species with large populations decreased rapidly last decades, and in some cases they become extinct from the wild. In both of that cases, involved species that are threatened with extinction. So, the International Union for Conservation of Nature provided in 1994 the criteria and the red list categories to objectively assess the conservation status of species. After that, most of vertebrate species have been assessed and classified in one of different red list categories. The assessment should be applied in a relatively short time in order to identify if species are continuing to face threats. So firstly, I will show you the red list categories of IUCN and the criteria that used to assess the wildlife species. There are 8 categories, plus one, the data deficient category, in which every taxon can be classified. The first category, the extinct, means that the last individuals has died, while the second category, extinct in the wild, means that the species is extinct in its natural habitat. The following three categories, critically endangered, endangered and vulnerable, are assigned to taxa on the basis of quantitative criteria and are assigned to reflect varying levels of threat of extinction. Species that belong to these three categories are referred as threatened. We will see the criteria in the next slide. The last categories are applied to species that do not qualify as threatened, while a near threatened category may be close to qualifying as threatened in the future if conservation actions abate or cease. So in this slide, you can see the 5 criteria that used to evaluate a taxon as critically endangered species. The first criterion is the proportion of reduction of population size of a species under the time period specified or in 3 generations based on any of A1 to A4 sub-criteria. The second criterion of geographic range is either the extent of occurrence, which is the area contained within the shortest continuous imaginary boundary, which can be drawn to encompass all the known inferred or projected sites of present occurrence of a taxon, excluding cases of vagrancy, or the area of occupancy, which represents the area of suitable habitat currently occupied by a taxon. The third criterion is referred to small and declining population size, and for critically endangered species, its population must be estimated to number less than 250 mature individuals and to either C1 have an estimated continued decline of at least 25% within 3 years or 1 generation, or C2 have a continued decline in the number of mature individuals and one of the following 3. Less than 50 mature individuals in each subpopulation, or 90 to 100% of mature in one subpopulation, or extreme fluctuation of mature individuals. The fourth criterion is referred to very small population or very restricted distribution and taxon classified as critically endangered if the population size is estimated to number fewer than 50 mature individuals. This threshold changes to less than 250. Here, in endangered species, or less than 1,000 of mature individuals in vulnerable species. The fifth criterion is referred to quantitative analysis of extinction risk by using, for example, the population viability analysis. The probability of extinction in the wild for critically endangered species is estimated to be more than 50% in 10 years or in 3 generations. According to IUCN criteria classification, the numbers of species listed in each red list category is shown in this slide. Numbers in blue are from species assessed during 2019, just 1 year ago, while in parentheses are from the last version of species evaluation during 2017. The total number of species listed in this table changed between these two assessment periods, as well as the number of species in most groups has changed, because some species are being reassessed and resulting in moving into different category, or other species added to the list for first time. If we see this table carefully, different vertebrate classes face different risk of extinction, with one third of amphibians being included as threatened, followed by mammals, which is about 21%, and birds about 13% as threatened species. In 1994, a very influential paper was published by Cochley, and in this paper, Cochley suggested that there are two main paradigms followed by conservation biologists, and that these themes have some distinctive characteristics. He referred to the first as the small population paradigm, which focuses on rare and endangered species and the persistence of populations. Much of the work in this area focuses on the prevention of extinction risk. Characteristics of small populations are firstly the small population size and the low fecundity rate, secondly, the restricted geographic range, and thirdly, the specialized habitat requirements, for example, like bats and vultures. In this area, a lot of theory, practical techniques such as captive breeding and legislation has been developed the last years. The alternative approach was the declining population paradigm, in which the focus shifts to identify problems before populations are about to completely disappear. The main question here is why the population is declining, and here deterministic forces drive a population to extinction in a short period of time. Deterministic factors result from human activities are the major factors that decline the population rapidly, and they include the loss and degradation of habitats, overexploitation, introduction of alien species, pollution, diseases, and changes in the disturbance regime. During the last decades, especially conservationists have focused most of their efforts to those threats. So, I will start firstly to develop each of these threats. The loss of habitats and degradation of habitats are identified as the major threat to terrestrial biodiversity. For example, land use change from grazing pastures to agriculture is responsible for the extinction of 11 Australian mammal species and place significant pressure on a further 19 threatened species. Furthermore, habitat fragmentation and land conversion in Europe affected many species by reducing the amount of suitable habitat. For example, the local population extinction of red squirrel from many places of West Europe, as well as the population of capercaillie in Central Europe and the brown bear in Balkans. The excessive use of a species that has an economic value or overexploitation was the primary cause also for some species extinction, such as passenger pigeon, which this species was one of the most abundant species around the world in the last century. In addition, rhinoceros, whales, and other species, nearly and 70% of threatened marine mammals are also impacted by overexploitation, especially in the Mediterranean Sea. Introduction of alien or exotic species over the past 500 years was considered to be a contributing cause of 33% of animal extinctions. In another article, the same authors found that the alien species are the second most common threat associated with species that have gone completely extinct. The most dramatic effect are the stronger competition over the native ecological similar species or through predation on native species or through the transportation of significant diseases to native species. About half of the endemic birds, for example, in Hawaiian islands are extinct due to diseases transported by mosquitoes. Another example is the introduction of grey squirrel from USA to UK after 1940. And now, if you see in this slide, the species, the red squirrel has restricted the native distribution less than 30% of its distribution in UK. So, in addition to any deterministic threats, the small population may face, they may also face stochastic threats to their persistence. The four threats for small populations are demographic stochasticity, which includes fluctuations in individual birth and death, as well as in sex ratio, also genetic problems, loss of their genetic variability in breeding depression and genetic drift, and environmental stochasticity, as well as behavior problems. Demographic stochasticity arises from inevitable deviations around mean birth and death rates, because these rates are probabilistic. One easy way to understand demographic stochasticity is the next easy example with coins. For example, if we toss a coin 100 times, we will expect to have heads much closer to 50%. And if we tossed it 1,000 times, we would be highly confident of converging on 50%. The expected probability of heads. However, if we toss the coin only 3 times, we cannot possibly get 50% heads. We can only get 0%, 33%, 67%, or 100% heads by chance. This is analogy to sex ratios at birth in small population size. In a very small population, if, for example, a female produces only males by chance for 3 consecutive years and then dies, the population may also die out. An example of demographic stochasticity in sex ratio is the extinction of dusky seaside sparrow, when the last 6 surviving individuals were all males. The last male died in June, very recently, in June 1987. Genetic stochasticity refers to changes in the genetic composition of a population unrelated to systematic forces, like selection, inbreeding, or migration. This can have a large impact on the genetic structure of populations, both by reducing genetic diversity within the populations and by increasing the probabilities that deleterious recessive alleles are appeared. The loss of diversity could then reduce the population's ability to adapt to future environmental changes. For example, reduced heterozygosity from inbreeding increases the extinction rate in the butterfly Melittera kinksia. Finally, environmental stochasticity refers to variation in vital rates, such as birth and death rates, from one period to the next in response to weather, disease, competition, predation, or other factors external to the population, which they occur in a predictable pattern. Environmental stochasticity can operate in synchrony across large geographical regions. In addition, environmental stochasticity can affect both small and large population sizes. Populations are also exposed to stochastic events that are extreme. This is the catastrophes which pose a greater threat to a population than does environmental stochasticity. In this slide, Primack in 2002 summarized the extinction vortices that progressively lower population size, leading to local extinction. Once a population drops below a certain threshold size, then it enters a vortex in which both stochastic and deterministic factors affect small populations, tend to drive its population size progressively lower. What is this threshold of certain species? It is no good setting arbitrary population sizes without knowledge of the population dynamics or the natural history of the species. In general, bigger is usually better. The dynamic of large populations are largely governed by the mean, while the dynamics of small populations are largely governed by the variance. The larger the variance in small population fluctuation, the highest the probability the species will go extinct. Suffer in during 1981 proposed the concept of the minimum viable population. He defined the minimum viable population as the smallest isolated population of a given species having a 99% of remaining in existence for a given period of time, for example 1,000 years. Minimum viable population is critically important to planning reserves and has wide application to small and fragmented populations outside a reserve system. A related concept is the 50-400 rule. Sorry, 500 rule, proposed by Franklin. The 50 part states that 50 individuals are the minimum population size to combat inbreeding, and a minimum of 500 individuals was needed to reduce genetic drift in the long term. However, this rule is quite controversial. Some scientists question its generality, and others suggest that these numbers are too small, and in some cases, the body size should be involved in this rule. In the previous sections, we referred about the population size and we assumed that all individuals in the population were equivalent. However, in small closed populations, For example, without immigration, the presence of only a small number of individuals will lead to loss of genetic variation. This will influence the long-term persistence of population because genetic variation, as we referred earlier, is a requisite for adaptation to a changing environment. During the 80s, there was a lot of discussions for the role of population genetics in the management and conservation of threatened species, and the scientists suggested a term in which genetic variation is taken into consideration. This is the effective population size and is the number of individuals in a theoretically ideal population that loses genetic variance at the same rate as does the actual population. Idealized populations are based on unrealistic but important assumptions such as constant population size, random mating, non-overlapping generations, equal sex ratio, equal reproductive success of all individuals, no migration and no mutation. The effective population size is typically smaller than the actual population size, since in nature the assumptions of the ideal populations do not all meet. However, contrary to what is written and published in many books and articles, effective population size is not always lower than actual size. Effective population size is recognized as one of the most important parameters in population genetics and conservation biology. To predict the effects of population size on inbreeding and loss of genetic variation, estimates should encompass the effect of unequal sex ratio and fluctuation in population size over time. Let's see these two examples in the next slides. So, if a population has an unbalanced sex ratio, then effective population size is less than the actual size and can be estimated by this formula, where NF is the number of breeding females and NM is the number of breeding males. Let's see an example in a polygynous mating species such as the red deer. In a population with 100 individuals with 5 males and 95 females, then the effective population size is estimated of 19 red deers and not 100 deers. In a proportion of 20 males to 80 females, the effective population size is estimated in 64 deers. We can see that in both cases, the effective population size is less than the actual population size. Another case of smaller effective population size than actual size is when the population is fluctuating through time, as in most cases do. In this case, effective population size is estimated to be the harmonic mean of the actual size of each generation. Here, the estimation of effective population size gives more weight to small numbers. For example, if a wolf population is stable in two generations with 100 individuals and in a third generation decreased to 10 individuals, then effective population size would be 25 individuals, far less than 70 wolves, which is the arithmetic mean of 100, 110 individuals. How to prevent extinction? In the previous slides, we talked about factors that drive small populations to extinction, for example, stochastic threats, as well as those factors that even a large population may drive it to substantial decline, for example, the deterministic factors. In order to prevent extinction of a certain species, the first step in management and conservation of small populations or declining populations is to recognize the problem. Usually, smaller species, such as small mammals and birds, frogs and reptiles, are more likely to be disregarded than larger ones, for example, large ungulates and carnivores. The second step is to identify the pattern of population trend. Here, we have to question, firstly, if the cause of decline is single or a combination of multiple factors. Secondly, if these factors are still operating, and if so, would be they nullified? We usually list all potential causes that involved in the species decline, and then we eliminate those according to whether the predicted effects are observed in fact. So, how to prevent extinction in practice? If we identify a decline in a species and we determine the cause, then the problem will be treated. The measures that we would take to prevent the species extinction sometimes is just to change the legislation, such as the ban of hunting, for example. However, we take a number of single or multiple management measures, such as the rescue, captive breeding, and reintroduction of a threatened species, to manage feral species, to improve habitats, to establish new protected areas, and finally to develop suitable legislation. If a population consists of a small number of individuals, then we capture and keep them in special places, often in places similar with zoos. Then you have to know whether the species has the ability to breed in captivity. Many species do not reproduce, or they have less reproductive success when they are in captive in comparison to wild. Finally, if we succeed with the breeding in captivity, we should follow some procedures in order to succeed in reintroduction. It is important to know that the factors causing the extinction, whether or not it's still operating. Usually, in a reintroduction program, released a minimum number of individuals per year, for example, between 12 and 20. In addition, the duration of releasing is important, and this influences the total number of individuals that will be released. An important issue in reintroductions is the continuing monitoring of all released individuals in the wild. There are many successful reintroduction programs, but here I will present some of them around the world, such as the peregrine falcon in North America, the white-tailed eagle in Scotland, and the griffon vultures in the Alps. Many species around the world are feral due to releasing by their owners. Many works around found a strong negative impact of feral species on native species of small populations due to predation. For example, in Australia, in a recent work, they found that approximately 316 million feral cats are roaming free. They estimated in this work a predation rate of 129 birds per cat per year, which give a total of 377 million killed birds per year, including some rare bird species. Here, especially in feral species, the measures that taken is usually the maintenance of feral species in certain places, and in some cases their sterilization, and then their releasing if the species are not predators. Another conservation measure is the habitat improvement. We can improve habitat characteristics by establishing feeding station, for example, for vultures or other scavenger birds, by providing artificial nest sites as well as roosting sites. Feeding stations are a successful conservation measure when food is in shortage and have been used in many countries the last 40 years. By providing artificial food to the feeding station, we increase the available food for scavengers, vultures, kites, and other birds of prey, which in turn increase the breeding success and the survival rate of young in those species. In addition, that species provided with safe food, and thus they decreasing the chances of killed by poisons. Finally, feeding stations benefit the economy of local communities, as well as they keep young people close to nature. A successful example is coming from northeastern Greece, where in 1987, a feeding station has been established where there were 20 individuals of black vulture, approximately. Today, after 44 years, the population is consisting of 130 individuals and more than 30 breeding pairs per year. Another important conservation measure is the provision of artificial nets when the limiting factor of the species is the shortage of suitable nesting sites. Artificial nesting sites are increasing the breeding success and at the same time decreasing the mortality due to better southern conditions. A successful example is the lesser kestrel in southern Greece, where the species nest under the roof of old buildings. Due to demolition of old buildings, the population was collapsed in fewer than 2,500 pairs in 1999. After the provision of 174 artificial nesting boxes, lesser kestrels adopted them, and they produce in total of more than 3,000 young until last year, in 2019. Finally, the provision of artificial roosting sites is beneficial for many bat species that inhabit both natural or anthropogenic environments and may increase their survival. So, in summarizing, small populations are facing both stochastic and deterministic threats. Deterministic threats are accelerating the probability of extinction of small populations. However, many conservation efforts, such as reserve establishing, captive breeding programs, and legislation, were made to maintain their persistence in the future. In small populations, three stochastic interacting factors contributing to further declining: demographic stochasticity, genetic problems, and environmental stochasticity and catastrophes. In practice, effective population size is quite difficult to measure because of our inability to measure precisely the actual population size, as well as to understand the underlying assumptions of an idealized population. Human activities are clearly elevating extinction rate for many wildlife species, and practical conservation measures are capture and breeding in captivity, habitat improvement such as food supply, provision of nesting sites and roosting sites, management of feral species, legislation, and establishment of protected areas. Probably because I talk quickly, this is the last slide of my presentation. I provide some references that I used in the earlier slides. So thank you very much, and I'm sorry if I bored you with my presentation. I'm ready for questions. Do you listen to me?
According to, I don't know, some last research that you have participated in Greece or that you know, can you tell us, I don't know, the something like the most endangered species now in Greece due to reduction of the population size, like the last years, what's happening in Greece?
Oh, it is very, it is not easy. It is not easy.
No, it's not. It can be really connected to your personal work.
Of course, there are species that they face threats, and there are near extinction, like some vultures, especially the Egyptian vulture. I didn't have an example here. Especially the vultures in Greece are the most endangered, the critical endangered species in our country, and not only in our country, also in Balkans. Also the banded vulture, we have just 3 or 5 breeding pairs in Crete Islands, and this is the last population in southeastern Europe. So, banded vulture is the most critically endangered species now in southeastern Europe, followed by Egyptian vulture. Also, you have some mammals that are endangered, like lynx. The last individuals observed during the 70s in Greece. So we have some information that some individuals observed in our northern borders with Albania, but we have not confirmation about these observations. As I said, mostly the larger species are easier to observe that are under threats. And as I said, vultures and the lynx, and also bears, are the more easy to observe that decreased during the last decades, and decreased rapidly. Do you understand what I said, Jordanka?
Yes, it's some similar situation.
So to summarize, banded vulture, Egyptian vultures, bears, brown bears, Any other question?
Hello, Dimitris. I'm Yannis Tsiripidis. I have some questions, but maybe it would be better the students to address some questions first. So I invite also the students to ask whatever they like.
Of course. I'm waiting.
Never mind, I will make a question two or three questions. Just a very obvious question is when the population size is very small and we apply measurements like capturing and breeding, how viable is such measures in time? What are the possibilities to conserve a species by such measures? For instance, concerning plants, we sometimes call this as gardening. I don't know concerning animals how we can call it farming, maybe. But do you think that this is something that is viable in time in order to conserve a species?
Just to return to the slides, I said that there are some examples when the population is reduced just to a few individuals. The usual measure is to capture all of them and then to keep in captivity in places similar like zoos. But the problem is that some species reproduce in captivity, in order to maintain as a species for the future, but some species they didn't. So the common measure that happened applied during the past and also recently is firstly to collect and to capture all individuals and then to save in safe places, in safe special places.
Dimitris, do we have some examples where a species was breeding in captivity and then it was again liberated free in nature and the population increased and the conservation was successful?
Of course, we have, for example, the Arabian antelope. The few last individuals in the Arabian Peninsula collected and captured in Israeli zoos. And after the captive breeding, the population increased and then reintroduced again in the wild. This happened during 30 years ago, if I remember well. Another example of successful captive breeding species that breeds in captivity was from, I don't remember the Latin name, it is a golden lion tamarin. It's a monkey anyway that was that had a very small population in South America, and after the breeding in captivity, again released and reintroduced successfully. So there are some, of course, that I have in my mind now. There are some examples.
Okay, thank you. Another question I have is for how many species we estimate that there are studies about viable populations in Greece or in Balkan Peninsula, for instance?
Could you, Could you tell it again? Yeah, it's just there is an answer and a question from a student if there are any reintroduction exams from Greece. As far as I know,
For how many species, animal species, would have studies about the size of viable populations?
What?
For how many species who have studies already done about the size of a viable of their viable population? How many species who have this information?
Actually, I don't know because, okay, we estimate the minimum viable population, mm-hmm. but because it is very controversial, there are a lot of arguments between scientists. Actually, we don't know. I mean, for the whole species, the minimum viable population, because it depends from the habitats, from the body size. So there are a lot of parameters that influence the minimum. If you ask me about the minimum viable population,
yes, this is the question.
There are a lot of factors that involved in the estimation of this parameter. So actually, we don't know for the whole species. Just if a species is declining, for example, we can estimate these numbers for a specific region, but there are no numbers. I mean, in literature. There is a question if there are any reintroduction examples from Greece. As far as I know, there are no.
Okay, and what we can do, for instance, for the implementation of some conservation policies, like the Habitat Directive. In Habitat Directive, for instance, we have to set the target population for each species that is included in Annex 2 of the Habitat Directive. So how we can estimate this target population size for the species protected from the directive?
Yes, this is another story, and it's quite complicated field in order to develop now. And of course, we take into consideration the critical habitats for some species, but this is another field of study. Mm.
Okay, Dimitris, thank you very much.
If there are any other questions, please. We have a question, but it's not relevant to our presentation, to our talk, to my talk. The question is, what's my opinion about Australia's wildfires affecting to the wildlife? Actually, as I said, the catastrophes, which includes wildfires, it is an important factor that may drive many species to extinction, and especially in a continent like Australia. Because the wildfires are very recent, we don't know exactly the numbers of the species that affected, but these events. So I assume that, of course, the wildfire affected strongly and negatively many species, and especially many rare species in Australia, but we will wait from other scientists to study and to see what happened, finally. Any other question, please?
I can. I can just shortly tell about some reintroduction efforts in Bulgaria, if it is interesting for the people.
Yep, I know Zordanga, but I didn't include it because we don't know the results yet. We have no any. We have some observations about some poisonings, but okay, you can refer it.
Yeah, it's a matter of discussion, and definitely more expert people should get involved in that discussion. But just wanted to inform the people that there are some projects ongoing for reintroduction of species in Bulgaria. And for example, there were efforts for reintroduction of lesser kestler.
I know.
And also in Greece, like transboundary, or maybe near the border, I'm not sure.
Northeastern Greece, because we observe some individuals from there. I know this project.
Yes, and I don't know, most of the spaces that they put for nesting were occupied after that. And it's considered to be somehow successful. Also, there are efforts for reintroduction of European bison and also on fallow deer. Mm-hmm. This is like more on national level, or small locations like regional levels. There are also efforts to reintroduce in some regions red deer and chamois, even this fish that is, I think, in conservation importance, this Cotus gobio.
Okay.
Also some efforts for that.
That's very good. I know that you run the rewilding, all these reintroduction programs are under the Rewilding Europe?
Not all of them, no. Also, Green Balkans Federation is involved, some small associations that work with rivers are involved, different associations. Yes, but in Eastern Rhodopes, the Rewilding Europe is the most active, yes.
And the last example is with black vultures, I think.
Maybe, but this is also something done, I think, from Bulgarian Society for Protection of Birds. And I don't know if somebody can share from the students, because they have so large network of volunteers that they include in their work. But obviously there are some efforts in our region to reintroduce species already.
But can I ask you something, Zordanga? Do you have any information about the lesser kestrels?
I just have read something about their efforts, but I'm not able to give some more specific information. If you're interested in that, I can search and send you after that.
Because just to explain, here in Central Greece, we ran two different projects. There was a life project from the University of Thessaly, and also we ran in another area our project which we started in 1999. 20 years ago. Last year, that's what I said. I asked about the lesser kestrels in Bulgaria, because last few years, I mean 3-4 years, we observed that most of the nest boxes occupied by jackdaws. And the life project, because finished 2 years ago, most of the nest boxes are provided for lesser kestrels, because they didn't have more people to monitor. That's why I said about the monitoring. They didn't monitor, they didn't continue to monitor the nest boxes. Most of the nest boxes that provided for lesser kestrels now occupied by jackdaws. Mm. That's why I ask you, because in our colony, it is quite hard. I mean, it's quite hard every year to go and to control all this competitive population from jackdaw. It's quite hard. But we succeed. But anyway, I mean in our region it's not actually the reintroduction, just we improve the nesting site for a species. It's not a reintroduction actually. Okay. I have a message from Polina Christova, and she says that Green Balkans is running a project now for reintroduction of the black varsum in Stara Planina, mountain in Bulgaria as well. Okay, and also somebody wrote about the laser kestrels.
Yeah, I just checked who was what was the project, because you can then we can examine it more closely, the project results.
But because they have similar requirements, I mean similar requirements with jackdaws, laser kestrels, and jackdaws are resident species. Mm-hmm. And they remained during the winter, occupied the nest boxes, and then they didn't allow the laser kestrels when they arrived from migration during spring. This is the most interesting and most important, most difficult in order to manage, to conserve the species, especially if we provide nest boxes. We have to monitor and we have to follow every year all the nest boxes, one by one. We have another question.
Another question, Dimitris.
I have a question from a student. In order to preserve some populations, especially migrants, do you think that Greece must control feral species like cats? As far as I know, of course, I agree that in order to conserve some very rare species, we have to control feral species like cats. As far as I know, in an old project from Hellenic Ornithological Society, they controlled rats in some small islands in order to conserve, in order to protect some birds. But of course, we don't know about the impacts of species like feral cats, or not only of feral cats, like feral wild pigs, feral pigs, feral dogs in some cases. Yannis, what did you ask me?
No, I just said that there was a question in the chat. So you just answer it.
Any other question, please?
I want to invite you to, if you have questions, to really ask them, because we're already running out of time.
Okay. Thank you.
Students are meeting you in the lectures.
Okay. Thank you very much, everybody, for attending me.
You can write your email for contact if it was not the appropriate time to ask a specific question, but it's something for discussion, or to ask outside of the webinar. If it is okay for you, you can provide your email in the chat, and we can put in the webinar Facebook event also. We're also recording the webinar itself, so it will be available in the Facebook and also in the website of Future Environmentalists project that we make together with two Bulgarian organizations, Aristoteles University and the Czech University of Life Sciences. So you can see it afterwards there and share it to somebody who was not able to attend. Thank you very much.
Also, I thank you very much, all of you, for your attention. Have a nice afternoon and see you next time.
Yes.
Okay, bye-bye.
Thank you, bye-bye.